Welcome to the Archaeology Studio. In this installment of Ask an Archaeologist, the question is, how do you manage academic debates? My personal approach with debates in any scenario involves two steps. First, I start with identifying the strengths and the weaknesses in whatever logical argument is being presented. Second, I consider the possibilities for maximizing the strong points and overcoming the weak points. Ultimately, in archaeology, almost any debate can be reduced to an evaluation of whether or not the site-specific datasets are relevant and sufficient for proving or disproving a proposed hypothesis. You should be able to recognize what evidence would convince you that an idea has been proven or disproven, even if the result would require you to change your original preconceived opinion before you knew about the actual evidence. This approach differs from a debate in the classical sense of a competition between two or more positions. I prefer to work on making a strong argument in itself, regardless of any outside criticism. In this strategy, I can build an argument that can withstand critical thinking in general, and then I can work on improving the specific points that may need more attention. If you can develop your skills in critical thinking, then you can recognize how a logical argument is structured in any case, including in archaeology. These basic skills always will help you in reading and in writing. And I should stress that archaeology requires large amounts of reading and writing. As a discipline, archaeology involves logical arguments about how to interpret site-specific material datasets in two ways that ideally can support each other. First, the site findings can be interpreted in terms of what people did at a site, when those activities occurred, and how they related with other aspects of the natural and social environment of that particular ancient context. Second, after those initial interpretations can be outlined, the results can be leveraged toward addressing a larger, overarching research question or theme that potentially could apply in any geographic area or time period. You should be aware of the basic factual inventories of archaeological sites in their real-world physical manifestations, as well as the range of possible conceptual frameworks and research themes that relate with past human behavior in the most general sense. The more you know about the physical datasets that exist in the archaeological sites, the more effectively you can leverage those bodies of evidence toward larger research questions. Meanwhile, you need to be aware of the potential field of research concepts, or else you might not even recognize how to make your site-specific findings relevant toward one or more of those larger research concepts. Logical problems emerge when the site-specific findings do not match with the intended larger overarching research question. Using your skills in critical thinking, you should be able to evaluate two aspects of a logical argument. First, are the archaeological material datasets relevant for the question being asked? Second, are those findings sufficient to prove or disprove the proposed hypothesis? If you want to propose a hypothetical explanation about why people use different food resource strategies, then first you would need to find a site or a set of sites with preserved food remains. food processing tools, or other information relevant for identifying the ancient foods and then inferring the associated food resource strategies. If you do not have access to a site where you can excavate a relevant dataset, then you might need to rely on pre-existing site collections that always come with limitations. Even after you can demonstrate the relevance of one site assemblage for your question about ancient food resources, still, you would need to be aware of the constraints of your work within the parameters of a measured geographic area, time period, and cultural context. You can produce more powerful conclusions if you can compare your site-specific findings with the documentary evidence at other sites that, in total, can account for a broader range of variables. In this way, you can clarify the consistencies and the inconsistencies across geographic boundaries, time periods, and cultural traditions. Questions about food resources are overall simple to address in archaeology because food middens, residues, and food processing tools tend to be preserved in most, but not all, sites. The more of those details that you can recover from a site, the more thoroughly you can define the ancient food remains and then build your larger logical argument. In this strategy, you could choose from numerous conceptual frameworks that relate with food resources, drawing from themes of habitat ecology, niche construction models, population demographics, and many other possibilities. You could apply any of those frameworks, but your successful application would depend on your ability to obtain relevant and sufficient datasets to prove or disprove your proposed hypothesis. You can consider other examples of research themes. You may be interested in studying the social structure reflected in house ruins, the combined technical and artistic choices that created diverse pottery traditions, or the different land use strategies that resulted in variable landscape systems. In all of these examples, you should be able to identify the site-specific material archaeological records that can relate with the intended research theme. In this brief outline of a logical argument structure in archaeology, you can see that the most critical point is the relationship between the site-specific materials and the larger conceptual research question. If you can concentrate on this aspect of a logical argument, then you can either avoid or resolve almost any potential criticism or source of debate in archaeology. Although my approach here is straightforward, disagreements and debates occur frequently in archaeology. Moreover, some schools of thought in academia encourage debates, and some academic career strategies involve creating criticisms of colleagues. In my viewpoint, most academic debates in archaeology could be avoided entirely, or else they could be transformed into constructive discussion toward improving research. At its best, a debate can expose the strengths and the weaknesses of a logical argument, or perhaps of multiple possible arguments. At its worst, a debate is not really a debate at all, but rather critics take advantage of this debate format to obfuscate and misrepresent the material archaeological facts and the thought process of interpreting those facts. In my career, I have managed academic debates through examining the logical argument at hand and applying basic principles of critical thinking. I have used this approach to improve my own work, to evaluate whatever I read or encounter in world archaeology, and to clarify what truly are the issues in an academic debate. In concluding this episode, now you should be familiar with how to approach academic debates in archaeology. Whenever you create or encounter a logical argument, then you should be able to apply general principles of critical thinking to clarify the strengths and the weaknesses of whatever logical argument is being presented. You can evaluate how well the primary datasets have been documented, and then you can assess whether or not those datasets are relevant and sufficient for proving or disproving the proposed hypothesis. Will you want to see more videos about archaeology? I encourage you to subscribe to this YouTube channel. You can explore the online archive of episodes and playlists, and you can see new content every month with the Archaeology Studio.